once the intelligence is gone, smriti brahmasyat buddhinaso. When the buddhi is gone, buddhi is finished, then buddhinasa pranasyati. Then pranasyati. One is finished, one has fallen over. So this is the 8-step process. Dhyayato vishayan punsa sangaste supajayate, sangat sanjayate kama kama krodha vijayate, krodha bhavati samoha, samoha smriti brahma, smriti brahmasyat buddhinasyo, buddhinasyat pranasyati. So this is the 8-fold process of decline that one can go through if he doesn't catch his mind in time. So at what level can one catch one's mind where one can reverse it, when one can turn it back the other way? Is there a threshold that one can then reverse it from? So it's very interesting how Krishna ends that translation by saying that he falls down again into the material whirlpool. A whirlpool is something that's spinning. It's constantly spinning with a vortex. And anything that gets into that, it just spins on the outside for a few seconds and then it gets sucked in. It goes down. So after that, there's no trace of it. You cannot trace it. It's just gone down the vortex. So Krishna is saying he again falls down into the material whirlpool. That means he was not there. His consciousness was actually good. His consciousness was actually connecting on the spiritual platform, but it was not efficient enough. It was not sufficient enough. It was not sufficient to help him through the whole day. So devotees, this is where you have to consider your lifestyle. If your life is a high intensity lifestyle, you're going to need a high intensity practice to balance that. If you don't afford a high level practice, then what you are doing is only helping you for 20-30% of life. It's not going to be enough to help you to counterbalance life. You see the difference? That what you are doing is helping you, but it's not enough to help you all the way. What it's doing is it's giving you a certain release. It's giving you a certain experience that can help you momentarily. But it's not helping you throughout the day. It's helping you in one or two events of your life. Maybe it's helping you in your family and social life. But if you're going to go through all the day, which means with work, which means with life, which means with your own internal development, which means with all your interactions, then how intense is your spiritual workout right now? Is it enough to last you all the way? Well, I don't think so. The fact that you're following this video series means you know within yourself that you need to be doing more to handle and balance your life. Unless you're able to connect it more until it becomes a total lifestyle, then only doing a partial practice will only give a partial result. You'll only be able to handle parts of the day. You'll not be able to handle the whole day. So it's very important that you think about that. How intense is your spiritual workout? Is it as intense as your life? Well, it has to be. Otherwise, instead of giving satisfaction, it's going to give frustration. And you don't want to be there. There is no positive outcome from frustration. So Prabhupada gives a very dynamic purport. He first starts with Rupa Goswami. He describes here, Srila Rupa Goswami has given us this direction from Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 1-2-258. Quote, by development of Krishna consciousness, one can know that everything has its use in the service of the Lord. Those who are without knowledge of Krishna consciousness artificially try to avoid material objects. So you see again how practical the process is. Remember, we keep mentioning this, that the process to connect to the spiritual platform is called Krishna consciousness. And that is the most practical activity one can do, because all the other processes are advocating to give up. To give up this, give up that, give up the material objects. Krishna consciousness is saying, yukta vairagya uchyate, connect it in yoga, yukta. connected, learn the art of how to connect everything. If this whole creation was given by God, then surely there must be a way to connect it to Him, to spiritualize it. If we try to approach it separate from that, then frustration. If we try to approach it connected to that, then satisfaction. This is as simple as that. And Rupa Goswami is quoting this, that the process of Krishna consciousness is meant to help one connect all the material objects on the spiritual platform. And if one doesn't do that, then it's simply he doesn't know how to do that. And he's quietly living his frustration because he thinks he has to give up something. He has to give up everything. So he continues here. And as a result, although they desire liberation from material bondage, they do not attain the perfect stage of renunciation. See, what is perfect renunciation? Prabhupada gave that definition of detachment. Detachment means simply attachment of everything to Krishna. It's as simple as that. Whatever you're thinking of detaching means you don't know how to attach that to the spiritual platform. And now Prabhupada is saying here that the perfection of renunciation is this, that one who is perfectly renounced, he is able to understand how to connect everything on the spiritual platform. If you try to renounce or give up something, was it yours in the first place? If it wasn't, then what are you giving up? How can you say you gave it up? So this is perfect renunciation. It makes sense. It's amazingly logical. So he continues. Their so-called renunciation is called phalgu, or less important. On the other hand, a person in Krishna consciousness knows how to use everything in the service of the Lord. Therefore, he does not become a victim of material consciousness. You see, it's as simple, as straightforward as that. You don't become a victim. Right now, you're a victim. You're a victim of material nature. You're a victim of material consciousness. Why? Because we don't know how to connect it. We don't know the yoga, how to connect the material things to the spiritual platform. Once you know that, you're no longer a victim. You are completely liberated. Let's see further. For example, for an impersonalist, the Lord or the Absolute Being impersonal cannot eat. Whereas an impersonalist tries to avoid good eatables, a devotee knows that Krishna is the supreme enjoyer and that he eats all that is offered to him in devotion. So we see that Krishna is describing at the end of the 5th chapter, in the 9th chapter, in the 5th chapter, Bhokta Jagatapasyanam Sarvaloka Maheshwaram Surita Sarvabhutanam Gyatvamam Shanti Michiti. So he's describing the Bhokta Jagya Tapasyanam, that Bhokta, I am the supreme enjoyer. Bhokta Jagya, of all the yagyas, whatever yagyas are done, it's meant for me. Bhokta Jagya Tapasyanam, and all the austerities people do, all of those are dedicated to me. And Sarvaloka Maheshwaram, I am the Maha Ishwar, the great controller, Sarvaloka of all the planets. Sarvaloka Maheshwaram. And although I'm so great, Surita Sarvabhutanam, I'm also your well-wishing friend. And Gyatvamam Shantir Michati, that if you really want Shanti, peace, then Gyatvamam Shantir Michati, then know this about me. Once you know this about me, you will be peaceful. You will be peaceful in life. This is the peace formula. And again in the 9th chapter, as Prabhupada is saying, the devotee doesn't avoid all the eatables. Certain things that are prohibited we avoid, but everything else is offered. Krishna describes, Patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhakta prayojati tataham bhakti uparitam asnami prayata atmanaha. 9.26, he says that offer me a fruit, flower, leaf or water with devotion. If you offer that with devotion, then I will accept it. And so who can't offer water? Even if you don't have expensive eatables, you have water, you have a leaf, you can grow a tulsi plant and offer one tulsi leaf. So anybody can do these things. It's practical for everyone. And the point is, we are the ones who benefit the most because we're spiritualizing life with spiritual energy. We're using a different fuel. Our fuel is spiritual energy. It's no longer material energy. And how does it come about? By spiritual consciousness, by changing your consciousness. So he concludes here. So after offering good eatables to the Lord, the devotee takes the remnants called prasadam. Thus, everything becomes spiritualized and there is no danger of a fall down. So you see how the devotee prevents a fall down? Why? Because he's spiritualizing his whole life in a very practical way. So in that way, he protects himself from fall down. Just see, because he's designed every part of his life. It's a lifestyle. It's a spiritual lifestyle. And that process is called Krishna consciousness. So he concludes here. The devotee takes prasadam in Krishna consciousness, whereas the non-devotee rejects it as material. So this is the difference, frustration and satisfaction. You take spiritual food, you feel satisfaction. You take material food, you feel frustration. Not only that, you don't know what they're putting in the food. Because food transfers consciousness. So if the people who are cooked it, do you think they're happy? Do you think they are being paid well to serve you there on a Sunday when they can be at home? So be careful. Be careful what you eat, because you can get very sick by that. So he concludes here. The impersonalist therefore cannot enjoy life. You see, this is what Vaishnavism means. Vaishnavism means sweetness. It means sweetness of life. How to enjoy life in a very sweet, practical way. This is what he's saying. All this teaching is meant to help you enjoy life. Now we're thinking we have to give up and avoid this and avoid that. Then where there's enjoyment? How there's enjoyment? There's no enjoyment there. But in devotees, we dance, we chant, we take prasadam. Prabhupada once gave a lecture. He said the goal of life, to dance with Krishna, to play with Krishna, to eat with Krishna. So this is where, these are enjoyable activities that we do in the material world. And once we learn the art of connecting it on the spiritual platform, then why to give it up? So he concludes here, due to his artificial renunciation, and for this reason, a slight agitation of the mind pulls him down again into the pool of material existence. So Prabhupada is explaining, why is it that you pull down into this pool of frustration? It's because of artificial renunciation. Because you're artificially trying to enjoy and disconnect material nature from the spiritual platform. Once you know the art of doing that, there is no more disconnection. There is yoga. There is spiritual connection. And once that is there, one can enjoy that. One experiences the spiritual energy through that object. But on the other hand, if one doesn't do that and try to enjoy material objects separately from doing that, then by the nature of material objects, one will be bound by the laws of karma. One will be culpable to the laws of karma, which will bind one by every action one does. And even if you don't act, that's also action. You decided not to act. That is also binding. So it's not the best bargain on that side. But on this side, on the spiritual side, just see such a simple thing as understanding the yoga and just see how one's life can transform on all levels of life. How can you get anything more practical than this, where your whole life, 24 hours, is a yoga? Do you get any other practice that can teach you that? Whatever other yoga processes are there is teaching one how to practice yoga in an ideal situation where there's no stress, where there's no anxiety, in a studio, in one moment of time. So the mind says, hey, no problem, carry on. We'll give you your 1 hour, happy hour. This is your happy hour. But life is not about 1 hour of being happy. Life is about practical experience, practical expressions of how do you change that spiritual energy into material experiences? How do you change the experience and understanding, the wisdom that has come to you through the spiritual energy and transform that outwardly? That is the sthita pragya. Remember that? स्थित प्रज्ञा खाभाषस समाधिस्तस्य केशव स्थित धीर किम प्रभासेत किम असेत ब्रजेत किम. हाउ इज ही स्थित धीर, हाउ इज ही एबल टू सिचुएट हिमसेल्फ, ही इज एबल टू डू दैट बिकॉज ही इज कनेक्टेड इंटरनली. सो वंस वन लर्न्स दिस आर्ट, वन विल सी, हे आई डिडंट हैव टू गिव अप एनीथिंग. ऑल द चेंज दैट इज हैपनिंग इज द चेंज इन द माइंड. वंस द हार्ट एंड द माइंड इज चेंज टू अंडरस्टैंड हाउ द प्रोसेस works, there's nothing to give up, and now one's whole life becomes an experience on the spiritual platform in a very, very practical, simple and efficient way. So what can be better than that? But it's up to you to choose. The choice is still yours. So he concludes here. It is said that such a soul, even though rising up to the point of liberation, fall down again due to his not having support in devotional service. So you see, the spiritual platform, the effects of Krishna consciousness is done through the process of devotional service. And that protects one. That's where mercy or grace or blessings is coming from. It's coming from the spiritual platform in the form of devotional service. So one gets protected by that. What protection you got from the outside in the material world? There is no protection there. But on the spiritual platform, on the platform of yoga, bhakti yoga, on that platform one gets grace, blessings, protection. Because one is connected to another spiritual being, not an ordinary being, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. So in that way, one is completely protected. One experiences such a deep fulfillment. One experiences protection and one relishes and enjoys life. Can there be anything better than that?